Hi everyone. My name is Arend Jan Kaufman, but I go by AJ, and I'm a freelance consultant, a technical consultant and trainer for Business Central. And I first want to thank DynamicsCon for organizing this event. I really like it. And today we're going to talk about advanced techniques in Business Central APIs. So that is what we are going to talk about. And I have a small agenda for you, but there will be a lot of content. So we will start with talking about deep inserts. That's about creating headers and lines together with APIs. So that will make your API calls a little bit easier, of course, and faster. We'll talk about batch calls, which will be even better when we talk about performance, because batch calls allow you to combine multiple calls in one request rather than doing multiple requests and multiple round trips to the server. And finally, we will talk about webhook subscriptions. And webhook subscriptions is about, how should I put that? Don't call us, we call you, in fact. So you don't have to do any request. The system is going to tell you when something was changed in the system. So these are the three topics. And let's look at the first one about deep inserts. So deep inserts is possible because the API pages do have page parts. So we are used to that in normal pages. We're used to that in, for example, the sales order page, where we have this the page part for sales lines. And that's a combination, of course, of sales header and sales line table. Now, those page parts in the API pages, they allow you to not only get the header and lines together in one call, it also allows you to insert header and lines in one call. So that part, as you can see here, is linked to the header by the document ID on the sales line and the field ID from the header. But in fact, if you look into the page, into the tables behind it, it's not really the sales line. It's an aggregate table that is used as a virtual temporary table behind the page. But it's linked on the ID, which is in fact the system ID. And by this, the API page can link the header with the lines. Now, if you call the header the sales orders API just as sales orders, you will only get the headers. But with your GET request, you can also read the lines together with the header with the $expand parameter. And this one, and you see an example here, and it will of course demonstrate that. This here allows you to get header and lines all at once in one go. And before I forget, you can do that both on an individual entity, an individual sales order or sales invoice or other entities that do have parts. But you can also do that in the collection of sales orders. So have a complete collection of sales orders, including the lines. I don't recommend that because that would result in a pretty big JSON payload that comes back from the server. But technically, it is possible. Now, when you get back that result from the server, you will get the headers, it's somewhere up here, and you will get the sales order lines nested in the header. And that exact structure of sales order lines can also be used to send the data to the server to create new sales orders, sales invoices, purchase invoices, or other entities that do have a header line, including your custom APIs, that would also be possible to support it in custom APIs as well. And that is what you see here in this example. And of course, I'm going to demonstrate that. You'll see here very small header, customer ID only, no other data. And it combines with the sales order line. So here is an order being created that has two lines. And the nice thing is that in the URL over here, if you can read it, and I will demonstrate it again, but you see that there is a dollar expand as well, but that is only needed to get the result, including the lines. You can even post this against a sales orders endpoint without using the dollar expand, but then you will just get the header back instead of the header plus lines. So that, of course, requires a demo. So that's the first demo I want to do with you. So I'm going to switch to Postman. And here you see the first call that I want to do. I'm running this locally against my local sandbox. I have my company ID already, got it ready from the database, and I'm going to open sales orders. And in this case, let me first go without the dollar expand, so I only get the sales order headers. And here in the sales order, and let me then get one sales order ID and store it in a variable, and then change the URL a little bit. So I store that into the sales order ID and add it to the URL, sales order ID. And after that one, add that dollar expand sales order lines. So if we do not use this and I ask for this record, I should do a get, of course, and send it, I will only get the header information. And if I do the dollar expand sales order lines, and I look then down here, I get another entity, another entry here, sales order lines, that combines all the data of the sales order lines. Now, exactly this structure of a header and lines can be used to create new sales orders. So that is what I'm going to do here. I'm going to post a new sales order. And here in the sales order, you see the customer, the customer ID, an item ID. The first one is of the is a table, and second one is some chairs. And when we create this one with the post, we will get order number 7. Including a couple of lines. When I go to Business Central here and look into the sales orders, that should be opening in just a second, then we can see that that order has just been created. And we will use this order in next demos as well. So this is our new order. Here is number 7, and I expect 2 lines in this one. There we go. There we are. An attendance desk with quantity 1 and a parish guest chair with quantity 6. So all of this created in one go, and we can, of course, add other properties to this request. For example, the posting date on the header, maybe a unit price on the line, or dimensions even, or another description. We can have the unit of measure. So everything that you see here, almost everything, I should say, is available to add into this structure. So that is how deep inserts work. Let's move on to the next one. See at our next topic, batch calls. And batch calls is something, well, first of all, you need to ask, why do you need batch calls? And I have only three reasons for that. Performance, for performance, and for performance. So what I mean is, this helps you in combining multiple requests. Do one request, send it to the server, and have only one round trip, and let the server do multiple requests, but perform him multiple requests, and then return you the result. In that way, you save yourself a number of round trips to the server. So obviously that is helping in performance. But what exactly is a batch call? So I already said it is a combination of multiple calls in one request. For example, you can create a sales order lines and return a full document. What I mean with that is what we just did with the deep insert, you insert a header and lines together. But what if the header was already created and you want to create lines in that sales order? You could do that one by one. Because it's not possible to create multiple records at a time in a collection. You cannot create multiple customers. You cannot create multiple sales orders. You cannot create multiple items, etc. But with batch calls, you can do that. With batch calls, you can create multiple records in one go. And with that, you could create multiple sales order lines into one sales order or sales invoice. But every individual call to a sales order line creation only returns that single line that you have created. So in the return from the batch call, you will have the created lines, but you will not see the full document, including the header, and all other lines that may have been already added to that order in the previous call or whatever. So that batch calls does not have to be a combination of similar requests. You don't have to do a call that only creates lines. You can combine it with creating lines and getting the complete order. You can combine it with creating customers, creating sales orders all in one go. You can combine it with deleting records and inserting records in another one. It's a combination of requests, and every request on itself is unique. So you could also do another example, create multiple journal lines and post those journal lines all in one go. For example, maybe you have a system that creates journal lines for salary, for example, and you want to create them. And with the batch call, you can create multiple all at once, but then you need another call to post the journal in which you have created those lines. But with the batch call, you can all do that all at once with one go. Now, for the batch call, we have a special endpoint, which is the $batch. So you don't use /company, you don't use anything else. It's $batch at API /v1. Because every individual request in the batch is pointing to the full endpoint, that you the full resource, I should say, that you want to do a certain action on. So how is that request buildup? We have two different body formats. The complex one is what is known as the multi-part mixed format, and that is the one that actually is documented. But you know what? That's a complex one, and it scares people. So luckily, there is an easy one. That is application JSON. That is something we can read. Well, most business center developers can now read JSON. I hope so. So with that, with application JSON, it's way easier. And you see that here as an example, on the right hand side, I have a request here, buildup of creating multiple sales invoice lines, finally post the sales invoice, and then get the posted sales invoice in the return. And that is something you you can do with a batch call. So let's take a look at the difference at the left-hand side. And I know it's probably a little bit small, but I will go into the demo and talk a little bit more about the parts. But at the left-hand side, you see the multi-part mixed, how that looks like. I'm not even going to explain in details what the parts are of the multi-part mixed. It's built up of text, the headers, calls, boundaries that you need to set. Well, it's a pretty complex thing to build up. At the right-hand side, you see the same request as on the left, but now with JSON. And of course, that looks a lot more readable. So what I want to do is to demonstrate you a couple of those batch calls. So I'm going to filter my list here. And here is number one for the batch calls. I'm going to create multiple sales invoice lines. Let me first go over the details of this this body. First of all, you see here that this one is built up from requests. Requests is an array, and we have multiple requests in this array. And by the way, you could also have one request, but that wouldn't make sense, of course. Every request needs a number of parameters. We set the method. What do we want? Is it a post? Is it a get? Is it a patch? Or is it a delete? Optionally, we can set an atomicity group, but that is officially not supported by Business Central. But the idea of an atomicity group is that if we put two requests into the same group ID, like I do now, so both are now having the same atomicity group, that would put those two requests into one transaction. Well, that's the ID, but that is not supported by Business Central. So atomicity group is actually something that you, well, you can just skip it. You can just leave it, which I will do right now. It's not really needed. Then we have an ID. That is the ID of this request. And usually I go with something like request one, and then also, of course, request two, something like this. Then we have the URL. And the URL here will be replacing the dollar batch. So if we put this this part here in at the URL instead of a dollar batch, you will get the normal URL where you will do a single request to. The next two parts are the headers, headers that you will normally define in Postman over here under this part. Or in your application, of course, by adding headers to your HTTP client that you're using. We set a content type, and it's normally enough to do content type, application JSON, or data metadata minimal, and the other one is not really respected as far as I have seen, so let's forget about that. We have the content type application JSON, which tells us what content type the body is. And then we have the body itself. And the body here is a body for a sales invoice line. And he's going to create two lines into a certain sales invoice. Well, I have the same example with the multiple journal lines. That's the one that I want to execute. So I have that body over here. Again, I have the requests, I have the method post and ID. The URL is going to be against a certain journal. I'm going to create a journal line. And in the journal line, I have an account ID. Of course, I need to have an account ID. I think at this moment I have not set this variable, so I will set that before I do the call. I have a posting date, document number, etc., an amount. This one is salary to Bob. You even see how dimensions can be added to this one. And the second one is the second request, which is going to be the salary to John. And finally, I ask the system to post all of this. Well, let's skip the post for now and just look into the journal lines after they have been created. So I will open the general journal. Here, this one should be empty. There's no lines in here. And before I can run this one, I need to get a certain account. So let me send this request to get my accounts. And this is, of course, something you need to do on your application as well. You need to have all those IDs. What was that? Salaries. Okay. So let's take this account ID, set it into the parameter for account ID, and that should work. So I'm going to send this request, get back at 200, okay. With the created lines, each line does have an ID. And if I now go back into the general journal and I do F5, I see the two lines coming in. So all in one go, I've now just created the two lines. Let me just delete the two lines and now try to post it. That will, by the way, result in an error, but that's fine. So I'm going to add that one request that I removed. So what is going on here? What I do here is I say on the same the same resource, the same journal, I now want to call microsoft.nav.post. This is going to post the journal. But beware, before we can post, the two lines that have been created here needs to be created successfully. Otherwise, we cannot post. And for that, I have added another property here that's called depends on. And if it depends on, I tell him which calls, which IDs need to be successfully completed before he can execute this one. If one of these fails, he will not execute this one. So that is a security mechanism, of course. So let's send this one and let's see that there isn't really an error in request 3, but request 1 and 2 did successfully complete. As we can see here, it returns the lines. So you see here on the ID, the same request ID. So you really need it to identify the responses. And here in request number 3, we see that the document number is out of balance, which is expected because I did not add the balance line. So I mentioned that the response does have an ID for each individual request. You must use that to find the response for every individual request because the response is not set to be in the exact same order as your request. it could be that the order of the response is different from your request. I never saw that, but theoretically that could happen. So that's something to keep in mind. So with the other demo, what I can do, that is the multi-part, I can here create a sales invoice. I'm going to create a sales invoice and post it all together. And no, that was not the correct one. That was this one should be. Yeah. So I need to have a certain sales invoice. I'm going to create two sales invoice lines on a certain sales invoice. For that, I need to have a sales invoice ID. So I'm going to read that as well. And finally, I'm going to post it. But with this output, there is something, not strange, but I did another parameter here that I want to demonstrate before we move on. So let's go for sales invoices and let's find a sales invoice that is open. And by the way, I say open, but beware that if status here says open, then it is not meaning that it is an open sales invoice, it's an unposted one. As I will show you, what I really need here is select is ID and status. So it makes my list a little bit smaller. Come on, dollar select. There we go. So I see a lot of paid invoices, meaning these are the posted sales invoices that have been paid. Let me add order by status, that looks even better. And here I have draft orders, and a draft means this is an unposted sales invoice. So I'm gonna take this sales invoice and put it into my sales invoice ID. Then I go back to the sales invoices badge. Now I'm going to create two lines. No, that was not that one. That was this one. And this one then. Yeah, so now I can create a sales invoice lines and it will be posted. You see it takes a little bit of time, but what happens now is that the sales invoice lines, they don't return any content. I have an extra header added here, prefer return no content, because I am not really interested in the result of every individual sales invoice line. I do that at the end of the batch, where I say, here I post it, and then finally I do a get of the posted sales invoice, which has the same sales invoice ID. And that one is, of course, depending on number three, and number three is depending on the creation of the two lines. So when we look at the result of this, I have two empty results for the sales invoice lines, but it does have a location with a link in case you want to read it. It has a 204 no content for the post, that is normal. And finally, a status 200 for the fourth request, and that contains the document, including the lines that I have created. So that is a combination of creating lines, posting it, and getting the result with a minimum of output, minimum of returned payload. Okay, so back to the presentation. That was a demo about batch calls. So the tips is to use the prefer header with return no content. Don't try atomistic groups, simply not supported, you will get an error. And what you also should look at is the batch size. You should avoid timeouts, because when the batch size grows too big, the whole time that is needed to process the batch will can exceed, and the limit for that is the processing timeout limit is 8 minutes, according to the documentation. All right, then the other topic, webhook subscriptions. What are webhooks? And webhooks, you know, that is the system, don't call us, we call you. It is a way of subscribing to changes that occur in the system, and you will be notified about it. Rather than that, you have to query the database and say, hey, give me a list of items, and then figure out if something did change, maybe filtered by last modified day time or other way. The system business center will notify you when something happens, when the record is deleted, or record is changed, or record is inserted. So these events, they are registered in the system and sent to you automatically to your client application. So that is, in fact, an automatic APR response without doing a request. You only register for the request once, and then you get the responses automatically sent to your system that is just sitting back and waiting for that information to come in. How does that work? First of all, you need to subscribe to a change in a certain data set. You do that with an API call, of course, you register yourself. Step number two is you need to process what is called the handshake mechanism to establish the subscription. So that is a mechanism that makes sure for Business Central that your application is really there, is not going to throw it into the into nothing, into the blue air. It really, there is really a system, and it is waiting for him to accept to accept the notifications. And finally, your system, the same one, of course, needs to receive the notifications, for which you see a small example in the picture. So getting that webhook subscription, what you need to do is, and this example is to subscribe to the customer's data set, to the customer's list, you call the API/v1/subscriptions endpoint. With that, you provide a notification URL to the website, web application system that is sitting and waiting for responses to come in. And you specify the resource for which you want to get notifications. The resource is the same as the part of the URL after the host name. Well, you can see that here in this example, and of course, I'm gonna demonstrate that as well. Now, what you get back from the webhook, if it is successfully registered, you get back a subscription ID, and a subscription ID is not a GUID, it's a text. You need to save that. You need to store that in your system because you need it later. It will, of course, have the notification URL and the resource, and optionally, it has a client state. The client state you set here, and that acts as a secret value that is sent with every a notification, so you can check it and see if it is really Business Central that is sending that information to you. So it's a kind of a security mechanism. And then finally, it has an expiration date. And the expiration date is 3 days later. After 3 days, this webhook will expire. I will come back to that on the next slide. So the handshake mechanism, when you when you subscribe to webhook, subscribe to a change, Business Central is not just accepting this. It is, first of all, issuing a request to the notification URL that you have specified, And on that notification URL, it adds a validation token on the query string. Now your platform, your application needs to grab that validation token and return it in the response body with a status code 200 okay. Then if the validation token is returned, and it must be returned in a short time, I'm not sure, I think it's 3 or 5 seconds or so that it must be responding to that handshake. And if you return the validation token, then the subscription is established. So that is important part of the notification, and it happens on the same notification URL that is accepting the notifications. So let's do a demo about that as well. Before I start a notification, I'm going to Azure, where I have a webhook sitting and waiting for me. So we can open the log from that and live watch what is happening. Open the monitor here and open logs. This will live give us a live view of what happens in the background. Okay, so I go to Postman and go to webhooks and create a new subscription, and I create a new subscription on the customer's resource. I send that one, I get back the subscription that has been created, and when we look here, we see some information that the webhook function processed a validation token. So there really something happens in the background. So what happens then if we're going to do a change in Business Central? So let's go to the customer list and let's create a new customer and then see the change coming in into the webhook subscriber. So I create a new customer over here and give the one a name. And it has been created. Now we can go back here. As you see, we don't get any information right now. No notification. And that is because the Business Central has now collected the change, but it waits for a couple of seconds before it sends it to the notification URL. That is to make sure that this record is not changed multiple times in a short time frame. Otherwise, you will have multiple notifications. Now, here we have it. It can take up to 30 seconds before this one coming in. What you see is we have a change type created and a change type updated. We have a resource, and this resource here is exactly the same as this one. So we have a created record, and the same record also was updated. But that's because Business Central saves, inserts the record first and then modifies it. That's the way how those pages work. So that's why we also see two notifications here, something you need to be aware of course. So make sure that if you see the same resource, that you don't process it twice. So that is quite easy, I would say. So back in Postman, we can now do also get subscriptions. So we do a get against the subscriptions endpoint. And we see then one or more subscriptions that we have, including an expiration date. So when you need to renew the subscription, you need to get the subscription ID and just copy it here. And then we need to renew the subscription ID by issuing a patch against that subscription. That can be with an empty body. It doesn't have to be anything, but it needs to be an empty one. And now we have an updated subscription that is now valid just a little longer, of course. And if you want to unsubscribe, you want to delete a subscription before it expires, then we just delete the subscription and nothing will happen. So that's also an easy one. Now we don't have any subscription anymore. So subscribing to Business Central is quite easy. There are a few things to be aware of. So the subscription expires after 3 days, already told you, but be aware of that. So you must renew, otherwise the subscription will not work anymore. The notification that you saw coming in already contained an insert, a create, and a change, an update. But it can have multiple notifications from different subscriptions. If you have a subscription, let's say at the customers and vendors, and changes happened to both data sets in the same couple of in the same minute maybe, then the notification can combine both customer and vendors into one big notification. What also can happen is you have multiple changes to multiple records, then the notification can even send a collection, not every individual record that was modified, but it will give you a link with a filter for all records that were modified. The notifications were not sent immediately, you already saw that. It can be delayed up to 30 seconds. You also, one other thing to be aware of is that if a sales line, for example, is updated, then the sales header subscription, the sales order subscription, will get a notification. So the sales, you don't have to subscribe to sales lines. The sales order and sales invoice, that they will get a notification if one of the lines was changed. So that is the webhooks. So we have talked about a number of advanced techniques with Business Central, the deep inserts to do header lines all at once. We have talked about the batch calls to have a combination of multiple calls all at once. And we have talked about webhook subscriptions, the mechanism where you will be notified automatically when something changed in the system. So I hope you liked it. Once again, I want to thank DynamicsCon for organizing this and having me presenting this this nice topic. And after this, we have a Q&A, and I hope you will have a lot of questions. Thank you.